So Mother's Day, I had two jokes I was going to tell. I didn't even tell a joke. It wasn't a bottom line joke. So I got to relieve myself. I'm going to go back to Mother's Day. Tell me Mother's Day. This was the Mother's Day joke that I never told. Yeah. So anyway, there was a Mother's Day on Sunday, and the minister got up in front of all the people. And there was a lady worship service that day. And she was like 99 years old or something. And the woman got honored her. So the pastor pulled her up, and she stood beside him in front of the congregation, and helped save everybody, a number of things. That was so good. And he brought her up here, she just about had made it up. She walked down to the cane, she stood next to him, and he said, it's Mother's Day, I want you to come up here, and in honor of you, I'm going to let you choose three hymns. Three hymns for the day. She said, oh, good, you know? She was all excited. And he brought her up and he said, well, you have time to think about it. What hymn did you choose? Well, she looked at the congregation and she said, I'll take him, him, and him. You're free to write. Well, that got a good one. That wasn't like my last bomb. The reason I bombed out on the last joke, I told her, I didn't understand it myself. I really didn't have time to figure it out. Never tell a joke you don't understand yourself. Now, in John 6, we were reading about Moses gave manna to the people in the wilderness. I wanted to tie that text in because somebody mentioned the Old Testament text of the manna. God fed them with food and dropped down for them to be taken care of. And then Jesus seems to be the example in John 6, after he feeds 5,000 people on the water, the people go, what do we need to do to be saved, to have eternal life? What do we need to do? They're going to do something. He said, this is what you have to do. Believe in the Lord, believe in me. Believe in me. And then he talks about, I, they said, well, Moses gave us manna. And then he says, not Moses gave you manna. God gave you manna. But I am the living bread. I am the spiritual bread. In order to be saved, you have to partake of this bread. See, I am the manna that will give you eternity. I am the living water that will rush up forever. You must drink my blood. Eat the bread. And you have to eternal life. There's nothing you have to do. It's something you have to accept and believe in Jesus Christ. And then, of course, now we're reading Revelations, and every other sentence is, remember, you know what you did. So somehow you have to put all this together, saved by the blood of Christ, yet don't think this means you sit back and go, I made it, and I'm going to work on it. No. It's telling us over and over again in Revelation, it's what you've got to do because it's the things you've got to do. And if I remember, I'll get to it. So Thursday was Ascension Day. Orthodox Ascension Day is history. All Ascension Day is Thursday. Ascension Day is 40 days after the resurrection. Jesus, after he resurrected state, goes and inspires his disciples. He gives the Holy Spirit to the 12 disciples, or 11 disciples in that room. And then on the 30th day, he's on the Mount of Olives, and he ascends in front of them, speaks to them, gives them a mission, and then he is ascended and disappears. And the angel says to the disciples, just as he left, he's going to come back. And his final words to the disciples is, Matthew 28, go and make disciples of all nations, and go and be with you always, even to the ends of the earth. That's Matthew 28. And then in Acts chapter 1, we have the same story with some other details. So what is Ascension Day really all about? Ascension Day, by the way, 50 days after his resurrection, we have Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit is given to everybody. It seems to me as I read the scripture, it was given to the disciples in the upper room, and then fully given to everybody at Pentecost. Thousands of people were converted. Ascension Day is the end of the greatest revelation that has ever been given. The longest revelation, the most complete revelation, the greatest revelation. It lasted 33 years. 33 years. Moses went on Mount Sinai, he saw the burning bush. The revelation lasted maybe a few hours. Other people are transfiguration. They go on the top and spend hours preparing for revelation. But this revelation lasted 33 years. People say, why doesn't God show himself to us? Why doesn't God speak to us? Why doesn't God explain himself? We don't believe in him. The answer to that question is, or that venture, that the thought is, he has. It lasted 33 years. What did he show us in those 33 years? He showed us that God cares about us. He showed us that God is involved with history. He showed us that God has done something about the people of the world. He's not somewhere far away, like that song says, from a distance, God is watching. Well, what good is that? You know, God isn't from a distance watching. God is involved. God is here. God is in the room. God is with you. When you're driving down the street, Jesus is with you. Always. Distance, watching, he's active, he's involved. And the ascension marks the end of the revelation of that truth. It was his weakness and his spoken truth. And the Apophon was said, and the end of revelation, and he formed the possibility of the period of gravity, right? The law of revelation, right? And Jesus was here 33 years. He showed us, he was healing. This is all revelation. He raised the dead. He cast out demons. He healed the leper. He preached love. He showed compassion. He forgave sins. He totally submitted himself to the will of God. He went to the cross and died for us. And when he was on the cross, he said, "It is finished." And they say, well, that particular Greek exclamation is not an exclamation of defeat. I thought that God had brought it over. Actually, it is a declaration of victory. In other words, Jesus was saying, I have completed everything God wanted me to do. I have done it. It is accomplished. The salvation of all people who believe in me is accomplished. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, and those who believe in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. Amen. And so this is the end of the greatest revelation God has ever given. And then it was the beginning of the mission of the disciples. He said, go out and make disciples. Let me see the article. There are a couple of articles. One of them goes down to the scriptures today. There is something going on in the world today. I just looked at the program in Pennsylvania where I said, the churches are closing the church. I thought that somebody in the presbytery said, what do you tell the presbytery? Churches are closing left and right. Churches are on the down sides. Churches are closing. People are not coming to church. And then I read an old article that I had. I had a great habit of printing the article, not looking at who wrote it, but I don't know who wrote it. And it says, the problem with churches today is we are in membership mode rather than in discipleship mode. And Jesus didn't tell us to go out and members, we tell us to go out and make disciples. When we focus on membership, what happens is the church becomes focused on itself. And the leaders of the church spend their time trying to please the members, get new members, plan programs for the members, don't make the members angry, make everybody happy, and focus on the membership. They do belong, but focus on themselves, but that isn't what Jesus told us to do. He didn't send the disciples out to say, we need more members. We're going to organize a church in Jerusalem, and we need more members. Sign them up and make sure they pay their per capita tax, God forbid, and make sure they get on the committee, and make sure they go to first attempt, and make sure they build the benefits and they all attend, and then if they do that thing, we're going to really give it to them. He didn't say go out and make members, he said go out and make disciples. That's why Billy Graham's ministry was so successful. Because he wasn't trying to get people to join the church, he was trying to get people to believe in Jesus Christ. And he said, Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. And so Jesus is asking us to go out and make disciples of people, make give them faith in Jesus Christ. That's what our job is supposed to be. So the ascension marks the end of Jesus' mission. It starts the beginning of our mission, which has to be a mission of love. We have a preaching task to tell the story. It's got to be good news. However, that's what we're supposed to be doing. Here's the story. Jesus said, Jesus didn't tell us to go out there and tell everybody about it. He didn't tell us to go out and judge everybody. He didn't tell us to go and tell everybody to serve God and mess up. No, he told us to preach the good news. Not go out there and tell bad news and mess up. You sin. You're bad. You're guilty. You're going to get it. Wait till the lake of fire comes. You're going to be sorry. No, he told us to go out and preach the good news. Tell people all the time. If you go to church and you don't hear some good news, you better go to another church. Because we're supposed to be preaching good news. What's the good news? The good news is Jesus Christ has come. If you repent and believe in Jesus Christ, you are going to be saved. And that's what we need to do. So this is a combination of being washed up a little bit and saved by faith, saved by faith, saved by faith. You're saved by faith from the fall, which is in jail. The jail doors open by the power of God. The jail is going to fill itself, and then they save him. And he says to Paul, what must I do to be saved? And this is what Paul says. He didn't say go to church. He didn't say go join the church. Go to buy a free Presbyterian church. Then buy him and baptize you. He said, no, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. He made him into a disciple. When he began to die in the cross, the church of Jesus said, Jesus turned to me and say, well, let me see your baptism certificate. Did you go to church last week? Did you pay your dues? We have been in the church maybe 4 hours or something. They all went to church because their sister died in Florida, and they were bringing her body and they went to this church to do a funeral. You know what they told them? We're not going to do a funeral because she didn't pay her dues. Well, I'll tell you what your dreams are. Your dreams are believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. That's the dreams. That's what you need to do. And then he said to the jailer, be baptized. You and your whole family. And they were all baptized. Everybody. All the kids. Everybody. That's when we started baptizing other religious adults. And they were baptized and they repented and they were saved and by Jesus Christ. And that's the mission. That's what we need to be doing. Secondly, we need to be using what God has given us. We need to be multiplying. Multiplying. That's the power of the talents, which is further than the Bible says. The power of the talents is, what has God given me? We need, by the way, you should know how to live right now and you get it done. But if you have to live right now, and right now, everything you can do now, that's what skill you have, what talent you have. What does God do? Now, people, a lot of people say, I don't know nothing. Well, that's not true. Everybody needs something. You need a good thing. Think, I'm good at that. I'm good at this. I'm good at that. I'm so good at this. I'm so good at that. I have this gift. God is giving me these talents. So the Bible says, some of you have 4 talents, some of you have 10 talents, some of you have 5. But anybody who's giving something, then you might say to yourself, what am I doing with these talents? Am I multiplying them? Am I reaching out with them? Am I doing something good with these talents? Or am I just sitting on the room and forgetting about them and not using my talents? Now, that says that you're going to be interrupted. God will come back. He'll look at you and go, okay, I gave you, this is what I gave you. You were smart. You could resolve problems. You were good with people. You could sing like a scholar. You were talented, you were hardworking. What did you do with that? You were saying, if you said, I'm just going to sat in my room because I was afraid if I could get mad, I'd make mistakes and say, you didn't have to go to the second level. wasted your talents. And what he said in the parable was, because a woman only had one talent, he put it, he got buried. And then he took it and gave it to the others, and he said, you're in big trouble. And what I'm saying to you is I'm going to be a happy place. There's going to be gnashing of teeth and weeping. In other words, I wouldn't take that word. Take your talent, and then in the next call, write down what you're doing with it. What are you doing? It doesn't mean that's all you're doing in the church setting. What are you doing with it? Where are you going? You have one point of personality. You're talented. You're using it for God. That's what I'm going to be judged by God. Then he sent the disciples out with a 5-star mission. Go on and preach the good news. Very popular. Don't be, look, when you go to a party or a social gathering, people say to you know, that, oh no, Joe Bob is here. Or do they say, hey, Joe Bob is here. This is going to be one heck of a good party. We're going to be a couple of people, things are going to make a big difference. Every time you come to a party, it's a great party. Look at Joe Bob, look at that, look at Joe Bob. How do they react? Do they say, oh no, here comes the square? Oh no, here comes the critic. Here comes the guy that moves everything. Here's the guy that takes away all our fun. Oh no, now we got to be good. Here he comes, he's ruining everything. And then they say, well, here comes the guy that good news. Here's the guy that encourages us. Here's the guy that keeps our wounds. Here's the guy who talks about God in the secondary slave. We all want to go to church. Here's this guy who comes with attitude. What kind of guy are you? What do you do with your gifts? Are you going up there with good news? Good news. Are you healing the sick? Of course, you're the doctor, but you're healing the sick every time somebody goes, I hate everybody, and you go, what are you trying to do? Try to think of a positive thing. Say something positive. Don't be drawn into that negative, evil behavior, whatever. Heal the sick. Be assumed you saw that put up on the sword. You need somebody to help people. Sometimes you do that by just listening. Are you listening to somebody? Somebody just told me that a doctor, and you took, and they said, he's a good listener. And that was healing you. So, are you a healing agent? Do you cast out demons? Do you see evil? Something going wrong? Do you see something about it to change it? Cast it out. Get rid of it. Are you drawn into a thing to become part of the problem, not the solution? Do you need to stay a part of Jesus Christ? Are you casting out demons? Are you healing the lepers? Are you raising the dead? You know, I've been doing it. The spirits are dead. You need the spiritual man, Jesus Christ. Those are the people you have to say like Paul did. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. How do you do that? Everybody's not going to see you, preach you. All you have to do is live a life of example. Be a Christian. Let people see there's a difference in your life. And you've got something they don't have. And then they're going to look at you and make a good for you to start it. What is going on in that man's life? Something is different. So that's the thing, that in the 5-star condition, Matthew 10, if you want to read about it, you've got to have the talents, you have to use your talents, that's in Matthew 24, 25, 26, something like that. And then you have to be saved, which is the story of the Jared, it's Acts 16, we're going to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. So, this is what you've got to do. Believe, receive in faith. Then you've got to use your talents for good. You've got to obey the commission of being healing, resurrecting, testing out demons, agents. And then by the grace of God, when you're all in God, you see, the Bible shows that there's going to be some kind of reckoning. And if he talks about it, the Revelation talks about it, everybody comes forward, and the sheep, the goats. The book of life, the book of judgment. Which one is the son of the man? Right? You should know that. You should know that. If you don't know that, I'm going to be you. And I'm sitting there, I'm saying, Lord Jesus, I'm going to be you. I will see you as I am Savior. I will serve you for the rest of my life. Forgive me the sins. Baptize me with the Holy Spirit. And I will walk in your way from this day on. That's what you need. It doesn't matter what church you go to, it matters what Lord you worship. It doesn't matter institution wanted, if I want to receive the living God of Jesus Christ to nourish your soul. Okay, that's my nose, right? I'm going to go people aren't meant to just be hurdles to you. Think about this. Everybody just wants to be. People, when you think of them, sometimes they resist you. They're hurdles, they're problems, they're distractions. Stop looking at people like that. Look at that, the people around you. It's a golden mine of resources. Everybody around you, they have talents, they have knowledge. This is what I've always learned and mentioned before. Learn how to tap into it. Use your talents. Ask them questions. I remember Dr. Morris, who was a good older man, and when I was in seminary, when people asked him how I was doing, he said, "You're a very smart guy. Whatever he doesn't know, he calls me up and asks me about it." He's a smart guy because he's always asking questions. I didn't know the answer, but I knew who to ask to get the answer. See, I know how. I don't need a computer. There's you all have a computer.
No more accidents, falling down, breaking on your bones.
no more suffering, no more pain, no more war, no more hatred. That's good news. And finally, the ascension tells us we should all be ascended. In other words, we should all be rising up spiritually. We should all be better today than we were 2 months ago. We should all be better next year than we are today. We should all be improving. We should all be growing. We should all be becoming closer to Jesus. This is what we're supposed to be doing. Using our talents, our gifts, our quest, becoming more like Him. This is a process. Rebirth is not something that happens when we come up and go away. That's the beginning. That's the beginning of your own journey. And you're going to mess up, you're going to make mistakes, you're not going to be perfect, but you're on a journey. So you have to do whatever it takes to keep improving. Some people write a journal, some people keep a diary, some people take a checklist, some people pray, just pray, 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 some people prepare themselves, some people do support groups, and they bless each other, and they get better, they approach you with Jesus, and you do better today. And then this is all you're doing towards rebirth. We are changed with the truth of our mind and our bodies are totally changed and transformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. That's the ultimate rebirth, ascending to Christ, who descended from God, ascended back, is coming back in it to get us. He's coming back at the right time to get us. Not one person will be left behind. Not one person will be forgotten. That's only a four page. That's only four, we will be taken up. We will be taken up to meet the Lord, and we shall be forever with the Lord. Isn't that great? Okay. That's it for today. Dear God, what a great hope that you start showing to us and help us to get it and incorporate it into our lives. Jesus calls us to love everybody, to bring everybody in, to make disciples of other people in whatever way you can. Example, words, telling the truth, the encouragement, the scriptures, pointing them in that direction, introducing them to someone who can reach them and we can, whatever it takes. But our mission is to make disciples of all nations. And you know the common orders of truth. Go and make the orders. Even to the end of the age. Go into Jesus Christ.